Hey guys, I thank you for listening to iWine Radio, and we are still the only wine channel on iTunes Radio. If you go look under iTunes Radio icon and scroll down to news and talk directory, and it's listed alphabetically, click on that and the stream comes up immediately. iWineRadio.com, where you can find links to individual guests. And if anyone's interested in advertising or becoming an underwriter or sponsor, please contact us at iWineRadio.com. We really, really appreciate your support. The more support we get, the more conversations I can have with fascinating people around the world, including you. If you have a story to tell that you'd like to share on iWine Radio, go to iWineRadio.com and contact us, and we'll go from there.
Hi, my name is Chris Clow. I'm president of Schmidtzona USA, and you can find us at www.schmidtzonausa.com or better, www.schmidtzonasales.com.
It has been a few years, oh gosh, it's been more than a few years, that I had the extreme pleasure of visiting Germany with Carol Sullivan, who put together a media tour. Very, very fond memories. Well, Carol has set me up with our guest today on Wine and Dine, Chris Clow, who is the president of Schmidtzona USA. And we're going to be talking about the 2011 Vintage Report. And thanks to Carol Sullivan, truly thank you, thank you. We finally have the perfect point person to help us set up interviews for several of the very, very old, hugely well-respected around the world German estates in the coming months. So Chris Clow is joining us from Maryland, and it's hot and humid. And what is it like in Germany right now, Chris? Let's say we're at the tail end of July, beginning of August. Is it humid there as well?
No, actually, this current year, they've had a considerable amount of rain and cool weather.
Ooh.
Which has, yes, been very concerning for the vintners.
Yes.
The good news is, I checked this morning, and the next 7 days, the sun's supposed to shine and the temperatures are warming up. So this is, as you well know, a critical time period for the vineyards. And if we can get some good sunshine now going through into August and then into September, we're in good shape. There's plenty of water in the ground, but we need to start getting a little sunshine on them.
Chris, can you please give us some background here? Schmidtzona USA includes, it's like an umbrella portfolio of several estates?
Yeah, well, here, no. Schmidtzona is, we came to the United States in 1978. And we originally just represented our own brands, and we wanted to do things a little different, so we formed our own import company.
Okay, because I know Schmidtzona as just the brand Schmidtzona Wines.
Correct.
Okay.
And we're owned, solely owned, by our parent company, which is Schmidtzona Weinkellerei in Longyearbyen, just outside of Trier.
Okay.
We came in 78, I started with the company in 1981 and became president of the company in 2001.
You've basically really grown up in that company as a professional.
Well, prior to this, I worked for a distributor. I was hired and trained by Schenley when they used to have their own distributors years ago. And prior to that, I worked retail right out of college. So I didn't do anything in my degree, which was in recreation.
Oh, my gosh. I was going to say, you didn't study business or anything.
No, not at all.
Oh, my gosh. Did you grow up with, Clow is a German last name. So did you grow up in a family that served wine on the dinner table, at least on weekends?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. My grandparents were first generation. They were born over in Germany and came over here. My grandmother always had wine. My grandfather was more of a beer person. But, yes, I grew up in that entire culture of German wine and food and sayings and language and everything else. So the whole German culture is kind of inbred in me.
Did you grow up in the Maryland area?
No, I actually grew up in Wisconsin.
Okay.
Moved out here, went to the University of Maryland.
Okay.
So
I grew up in Cleveland, and my father's side, it's all German, a lot of Germans in,
right.
in Wisconsin and
right.
in northern Ohio area.
Exactly.
Wow. Okay, so talk to us about, I mean, I'm sorry for interrupting you constantly,
no.
about Schmidt-Zona, which is, I'm so glad to make this connection with you.
All right. One of the things I wanted to do when I took over in 2001, was fortunate enough to be offered this job, was to kind of change how people saw German wines. German wines had always been a bit scary to certainly the consumer and even to the retailer and a lot of restaurateurs. They couldn't pronounce the names.
Yes.
They couldn't read the labels. They didn't understand what the labels meant. So we wanted to try to make it fun and friendly and approachable. We wanted to try to interact with the consumer as much as we could. So we started a campaign called our Little German Campaign, where we had this character, he really is a character, who just makes our wines look like they are something that would be fun to approach. We focused on Riesling.
Okay.
Whereas in that time period, when I first started with the company, everything was Liebfraumilch primarily.
Yes.
It was
yeah.
Black Tower and Blue Nun, of course, and
yeah.
Wedding Veil and all those. And we wanted to focus on the Riesling, but we wanted to focus on Rieslings that everybody could enjoy and afford and weren't going to be afraid of. So we did that. And also we recognized, or I recognized, that people, no matter how much you tried to teach them about the predicate levels, the QBA,
yes,
Cabernet,
yes.
Spätlese, and Auslese,
yeah.
they never really understood it. So we tried to simplify that by putting little descriptors on our front labels. So, for example, on Cabernet, we used a yellow stripe, and we put clean and crisp underneath it. On Spätlese, we used a red stripe, and we put intense and fruity. On Auslese, we put a green stripe, and we put sweet and luscious. So we were trying just to... It's the old keep it simple theory.
Yes.
You can keep it simple, and you can make people want to go over and look at it and try it, then you're going to be successful.
Yeah.
So we also decided to introduce some proprietary labels. Everybody had a Peace Porter Michaelsburg or a Niersteiner Gutes Dumtal or,
yes.
or whatever, the Grosse Lager wines, but only we could own a label that we designed. So we came out with a brand called Relax.
Oh, wow.
Riesling. And that was in 2003.
Wow,
and the
2003.
The whole concept behind Relax was we did a survey and asked people in one word, describe what the effect of wine is on you or what you want to do when you're drinking wine or why you drink wine. And the overwhelming response was relax. People like to relax with a glass of wine.
Okay.
So I went to battle with, back then, the BATF, now the TTB, on getting the word relax authorized. We trademarked it, but they didn't want to give it to us because they said it was indicative of a health claim. And you, obviously, in alcoholic beverages, you can't make health claims.
Yeah.
So my argument, and it took me a year to do this, but my argument with them was we're not making a claim that this wine will help you relax. We're just calling it relax, period.
Oh, yes.
No claims being made.
Yes.
So finally we won the battle. We got the name, and it's turned into a lifestyle wine where people see the name relax, and they immediately can associate with that. It's a very simple package. It's very easy to read. And we put it in a blue bottle, which at the time was relatively rare. Now there are a lot of blue bottles out there. And the success of that product from 2003 today has been tremendous. We do a little over 400,000 cases of Relax alone.
And is it all Riesling in the bottle, or is it Silvaner?
Well, no. In that, the very first one is 100% Riesling, and it's QBA.
Okay.
Now we've expanded the Relax line to include other products only because Relax has been so popular. Next
okay.
one we came in with was what we call Cool Red, but it's a Dornfelder.
Oh, yummy.
And we made it with a mouthfeel, a little bit higher residual sugar than normal, so that we got 26 grams per liter. Most Dornfelders you get are around 18.
Okay.
We wanted it to be have a little rounder mouthfeel and easily chilled, so we use the play on words, Cool Red, so it's kind of a chillable red wine.
Okay.
Then we've added, following the whole idea of the European community and the open borders, we decided to go ahead and look outside our immediate country lines and see what else was available, and we introduced Relax Pinot Grigio from Veneto, which has done exceptionally well. And we also have a relaxed wine called Relaxed Pink, which is a very fruity Spanish rosé.
How about any relaxed sect?
You know, we played with sect over the years. The only producer, two producers actually, that I'm aware of that have ever had success with German sect is Henkel and Deinhardt.
That's such a bummer.
I know, isn't it? Because Riesling sect, I think Riesling is probably the perfect grape for making good sect. It is. It's so clean and crisp and fresh. And we do have an estate sect from our Schmidt-Schenk estate that we produce. We sell just a very little bit of it in Florida. But it's just one of those wines we've never been able to market successfully.
And let's all. I know that there are some people listening who are not going to have a clue. What does sect, S-E-K-T, mean?
Sect is the German word for sparkling. Being part of the European community, we're not allowed to use the word champagne. I think America is the only one that can bastardize those areas like that. But we have to use the German word sect. It just means sparkling wine. Ours is a method champenois, meaning it's naturally fermented in the bottle. And then there's a dosage after, you know how the whole thing goes.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Sect is just the German word for sparkling.
Because when I was over there with Carol years ago, I remember that the Germans themselves were very, very fond of sect.
Oh, I think in consumption, they're, if not number one, close to number one. And it's just the first thing they do when you walk into their house is open up a bottle of sect.
And I remember also, and Chris, tell me how, because it's been a while since I was there, that I learned that the Germans were actually preferring drier wines, and so many of the producers for home consumption, they were trying to capture that home consumption market, that they were changing their wines to drier rather than for export market sweeter.
And they still are.
Okay.
If you're in Germany, the majority of wines you see on a wine list are Altrocken. You'll find that they're kind of moving away from the terminology Hauptrocken. They're going to Feinherb as a descriptive. Feinherb doesn't really have a legal designation like the other ones do as far as how many grams per liter of sugar can be in the wine.
Okay.
So it gives the winemaker a little bit of a leeway. Still is an off-dry wine, but doesn't have to adhere to that 18 grams per liter or less in order to be called a Hauptrocken. But those are the primary wines over in Europe. In the United States, unfortunately, or fortunately, depends on how you look at it, Americans have always talked dry and drank sweet.
Chris, just in closing, because we're out of time, and we'll talk about this again in a couple of months, the 2011 vintage, how is that looking?
The 2011 vintage was a godsend. We came off of 2010, which was a horrible vintage in quantity. 2011 was exactly what the doctor ordered. It was perfect in quantity and quality.
Chris Clough, president of Schmidt Zona USA.